I am a human. Hello, everyone. Welcome to today's podcast. My name is Brittany Simon, and this is our very first episode. And of course, I am dying of whatever this sinus infection is. I swear to God, I've been up for hours, and I feel like I look like I just woke up. I am going to do this anyways. It's the first podcast. I figure, fuck it. Let's just try it, and we'll see how it goes. I have been thinking about what I wanted my first episode to be about for so long, because it's just me. As much as I'd love to just, like, you know, have somebody to bounce ideas off of, I just have to talk to myself, which, you know, is the life of most YouTubers, especially in COVID. But I am excited. As much as I have put off doing a podcast, and as much as it might be awkward for the first time because your girl's never done this before, I think it's going to go well. Now, if you are new to my channel, this is something I need to say to everyone. I think humans are awesome. I think we're weird and different and funky and stupid and amazing and smart. And I think we're all kinds of things. I don't think we're obligated as humans to be much more than ourselves, but not everyone is the greatest community member and not everyone is the greatest individual. And so when we observe human beings, especially on this podcast, remember that I'm coming from a place of, I love humans and humans are gonna human. P.S. This is my merch, check it out, links down below. But it just means to meet people where they are on their journey, to be considering it that someone else's life hasn't been your own. And I know we hear this a lot from certain types of political people, but I don't think people practice it a lot. And so I just want to keep that in mind as we talk today, because today's episode is a little controversial. I just got water all over my face, much like that's a story for another time of something else I've had on my face. But in today's episode, we're going to talk about identity and what it means to be a person and what it means to be a human. And when we have these conversations, some people are going to feel like I'm throwing them under the bus, but that's life. We're all thrown under someone's bus at some point in our lives. As a person who's been minority status for all of her life and can most certainly play the who's the biggest minority or the least minority or the most minority, I'm pretty sure I'm going to win most of the time, but the point is that I'm an individual, and regardless of how the world decides to view me or view you, we all are people who come from different places and have different ideas of who we are. So, okay, as many of you guys know, if you're, you know, you've been on my channel, I co-created a philosophy called The Levels, which is basically just an observation tool, more or less than a philosophy, but it's an ability to access how we view the world and how we function in the world. If you guys haven't seen that video, for more context, check it out, links down below, or on a playlist on my main page on YouTube. But basically, it's a 1 through 5 observation system that allows us to understand how much the individual views themselves in and outside of the world. As an example, it's 2021, which I'm relieved about. I think many of us are. But in 2021, the world is different than it was even 5, 10 years ago. And as somebody who was born in the 80s, this has been a most amazing adventure to see how human beings have decided to be, but also how predictable we can be. I've been reading a lot of books. I've read thousands of books, but one of the books that I was reading, and I can't remember the title, so I'll find it and I'll try to link it down below, but it's actually written by a priest, which I know, hold your phone, you're like, what the fuck? But for me, I was raised Catholic, I'm an atheist now, which just means I don't believe in supernatural, magical, or mystical beings. I don't believe in ghosts, vampires, gods. I don't believe in demons. I don't believe in any of that stuff. I don't believe in astrology in terms of like how the gay people love to believe in it. And don't get me wrong, as a fellow queer person, I understand everyone wants to know my sign and my rising moon, but I don't really know what the hell any of that means. And so as much as I like to dabble and I'm always open to trying different things, I don't really believe in them. So that's something you should keep in mind. But in this book, he's a priest who's talking about how sex has like a social responsibility to the community, and how he predicted, it was written like 30 years ago, how he predicted that like non-binaryism would be a thing, how transgenderism would be more prominent, and how that would impact society. Now, I am pro rights, period. I'm pro drug, you know, use. I'm pro being trans. I'm pro being gay. I'm pro being anything you want to be. Like, I really don't think it matters, but I do think how we use these tools matters. So here we go. Okay. Are you ready? Okay. So Elliot Page came out and everyone had an opinion about it. Now, I posted on my YouTube community page, which I definitely post a lot to because I don't have a Twitter or an Instagram or anything like that. I posted that I'm really happy for him, that I think that he has the right to exist, and that I'm happy that everyone has been supportive. If you look at the way the world has gone, Elliot's coming out was such a comfort to how people have become more chill. I mean, most of society was like, okay, whatever. Even the conservatives I heard from, their biggest issue was, does this mean Elliot Page is now a white cis man? No, it means he's a white trans man, but I get what they're trying to say. The questions that came up were things like, well, how does Elliot's relationship now exist? You know, is his wife no longer a lesbian? How does that work out? And I think these are interesting questions. And as much as it can feel facetious or sarcastic, I think that they are difficult to answer for a reason, because we're living in an existence where words have shifted so dramatically, so quickly, and because of the internet, we're all aware that they might not mean the same thing to everybody, that there is more chaos. And I love, oh, I breed in chaos. I totally am such a person in chaos. So for me, I'm not worried about the chaos of the world, girl. Like, I'm all about it. I think the chaos of the world brings me comfort. I believe the world is exactly as we want it to be. And I know that's hard for people to process, because people say, like, no, we want a better world. But the world does get better over time. If you look at the statistics, if you look at the trajectory of human beings, we have always gotten better. I think the issues I take with society or humans is that they think for some reason that 2021 is significant. Like, it's any different than the 1800s. But, like, 2021 is just our time. We're just existing in our blip of history. So we're going to have our own challenges and issues. And I'm sure in the 1800s there was some, you know, bitch with a sign who was like, it's 1862. How is this not cool yet? But that's just humans. Humans are going to human. And we're going to have expectations of our reality or of our time in history as being somehow better. And because we have the internet, we think, like, this means human beings are smarter. But I could definitely debate that. But okay, so Elliot Page came out. I have my little computer screen here. My OBS is recording. Look at me trying to be professional. So Elliot Page came out, and they caused a question because they identify as a man and a non-binary person. And for a woman, I'm a woman. I've always been a woman. I'm a cis woman. I know I'm a woman. I've never debated whether or not I was a woman. But this offers us an opportunity to look within. How do you know you're you? And what does that mean? So I believe in the physical world. I do not think this is a simulation. And I believe I am a part of an ecosystem. I'm a person who was born out of a species called human. Sapiosexual? That's not the right one. Oh, can you see where my brain is going? But you know what I mean. I'm a homo sapien. I'm a person who exists in this world, you know? And I don't think I'm anything quite more than that. I'm not very special. I'm not a gift from God. I'm not a creation that looks like a God. I'm just a person. And because I'm just a person, I observe myself in relation to other animals and other people. So when we think of who we are, who's the individual, who is this thing, this fleshy fun bag that we exist in, right? I think I'm my brain, but I don't think of my brain as separate from me. I think I'm my body, but my body isn't separate from me. And when we look at somebody, another human being, who has an opportunity to vocalize how they identify, they are self-identifying. They're choosing who they want to be. Now, some people might feel like trans people in particular don't choose who they want to be, that they're born in the wrong bodies, or however you want to say it. And that's so up to the individual how you want to view yourself. But I do think there's, like, an objective way to view the self. And for me, I rely on, who am I in the ecosystem? I'm a human being. And though I have definitely met people and interacted with people who don't identify as a human, because I feel they are so outside of the normal human, they must be other. And though I've identified, or not identified, slow down. Though I've met people who are other kin, and though I've met people who identify as a man one day and a woman one day, one thing is clear, that to every objective person who has an ability to observe, these are just men and women who are on a journey of individual self-discovery. That no matter how much we want to play with identity, if I look at you and I've never met you, I can absolutely categorize you. And when you can be categorized, I think we have to be more self-aware of what that means. Now, I'm not here to tell you who you are. I'm here to give you tools and to have a discussion about how you can discover who you are. For me, if I'm alone in a room and separate from society and culture, because I truly believe you must do this. My earring keeps getting stuck. I am so sorry. But I truly believe no matter who you are in the world, You must examine yourself as an individual outside of the world and then identify within the world and see what happens. So, as an example, I'm a woman at my core. When I'm alone in my room, when I'm just chilling, the thing that makes me feel the most solid is the fact that, okay, I'm a woman, I'm chilling. I identify very hard with being a woman. I grew up a tomboy my whole life. I wore boys' clothes my whole life. I wear boys' clothes all the time now. My brother legit left for the military and he's like, do you want some of my clothes? I was like, I want all of your clothes. I love gender bending in those respects, but I've never not identified as a woman. I know a lot of cis women who identify, hold on, as a YouTuber, it feels really weird not to cut out all those moments, but I've met women who identify as non-binary and as women. And when I ask them what that's about, they say, well, I'm so other as a woman. People like Judith Butler, the feminist Judith Butler, where they say, I'm so other than a woman, other than normal women, that I feel like I need a new title. And for me, that just limits us to being able to be examples for young girls of the vast diversity of being a woman. So for me, I don't think tomboys or queer women who dress unorthodox or women who wear men's clothes or men who wear women's clothes automatically makes them other. I think it just makes them a person on a fashion spectrum. So I identify very hard with my core understanding of reality, which is like we are humans. There are men, women, and intersex people. There are people who are trans who identify as the other and adapt a lifestyle to represent that. And I believe in that hardcore. Like, I've dated trans people. I know trans people. I'm going to pull that whole I have a black friend card out of my butt. But you know what I'm saying, right? We know this. I know this for a fact. I've met so many trans people who have asked me, trans binary people, do you think being trans is a mental illness? I have a hard time with this identifier because I don't, because I think mental illness implies an inability to function properly in some aspects. Like I have borderline personality disorder, I have a mental illness, and at times in my life, though I'm over a year clean of having an episode, I know from past Brittany that I've had opportunities where I couldn't process reality in the most objective way. But trans people are sort of unique in that way. I've met a lot of trans people, people like Kat Black, who I really enjoy listening to, watching, and interacting with, where I feel like she has a very strong idea of what is real and what is normal. And I don't see her as somebody who's mentally ill because she's trans. Now, I'm sure you could talk about how it's an anomaly. I'm sure you could talk about how it makes them unique. And I'm all about that. I just don't like to categorize it myself as a mental illness based off of, it's even been really updated, but gender dysphoria and all of these things are kind of, I think, separate in all the ways from being trans, though they coincide. And so I know this is a complicated idea of like what it means to be the self, but I need you to stick with me here. So when I'm observing people like Elliot Page, what's the issue that comes about with her identity? Well, see, I just did it with his identity. I looked at the picture of Elliot Page and I identified them as Juno in my head, which identified them as Ellen Page, which identified them as a woman. And so my brain automatically went, her, even though, like, I know it's a him now, and it's like now. And that's hard because trans people have been pushing two narratives. When I was born and raised, when I was a kid, the narrative was, I was born a man, but I'm choosing to be a woman. I was born a woman, I'm choosing to be a man. Now it's, I was always a woman, but I looked like a man, or I was always a man, but I looked like a woman. But Elliot is actually an example of somebody who in their 30s couldn't identify whether or not they were male or female until now. This is very interesting, right? From like an objective perspective or a sociological, like just observing this person is a human who in their adulthood, way past adolescence, their brain is completely formed, identified as a lesbian, came out, got awards, got a documentary, was able to parade their queerness, their lesbianism, their marriage to their wife as something they could be proud of, something that said to the world, I know who I am. And I'm looking at them like, sweet bro, you know who you are. And then to come out as trans now is confusing to me. It's confusing to me because most of the trans-binary people that I know knew they were trans as children, right? So how did a person in their 30s not know they were trans? If this is how they're born. Now, you can't say that Elliot Page didn't have access to pro-LGBT circles. That's not true. You can't say that they didn't have an educational background. That's not true. You can't say that they didn't have access for money and doctors. And all. That's not true. They are actually the example of the epitome of access to things to know and feel comfortable in your identity. So for me, I struggle with knowing how to process a person in their 30s, not knowing if they're a man or a woman. And that's the basis that we need to start with. If to know who you are, you must know whether or not you're a man or a woman. And like I said, most trans people I know they're trans when they're younger. So for them, it's not a need to come out later. Now, this is not the same thing as people who are in their 50s and 60s who came out as trans because they never had the chance to come out as trans. These are not the same kinds of people I'm talking about. So it's very different to say I didn't have the chance because of my circumstance, my community, my finances to come out, but I knew I was. Very different than Elliot Page, who deliberately came out as a lesbian, married a woman, and had this whole show and everything that they did. So the question is, did Elliot Page trick us? Were they pretending to be a lesbian to make money? Were they denying that they were a man this whole time? Were they a man this whole time? Or are they a person who decided to become a man? Are they, like, what opportunities do people have to know who they are and to know the most basic thing about existence, which is whether or not you're male or female? Now, of course, I'm using male and female and boy and girl kind of interchangeably, and I understand people have debates over this, but for all of existence, we've understood that humans are male, female, boy, girl. So if we can't even decide as an individual the most simple thing about our existence, what our gender is, then how do we expect to know what anyone is? If I can't identify Elliot as what I see them as, right? And what I know them to be through science. And then they can't identify themselves because, I mean, they live in their own head and they couldn't figure out who they were until their 30s. That's crazy, right? But we're looking to these people for answers or examples or elevating them to a higher status, which I think is sort of interesting. It could be just that they're celebrities and America's obsessed with that. But one of the other examples I want to give is sort of gender bending. Earlier in this year, oh, I love Jana Mock. I have Jana Mock up on my thing because, see, Jana Mock is also one of my favorite trans activists. Her book is really fantastic, and her journey into transness was so relatable. She talked about how she was a young boy and there was issues of like homophobia in the house, how she experienced so much trauma but had so much understanding with the relationship with her brother, the things that she's gone through. And I don't want to give anything away. I really think you should read her book. Highly, 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 highly recommend it. But Jana Mock knew at a very young age she was trans. And so for me, like, I look at Janet and I think, like, yeah, girl, go get it. Go live your best life. Like, you are queen. You are everything. I love her. But then I look at Elliot and I can't help but raise my eyebrow at this person and think, why do I feel like you don't know? Why do I feel like in 10 years, Elliot is going to come out as something else? And the non-binaryism, I think, allows a leeway for that. I think non-binaryism, for people who are new to my channel, is co-opted from the East. It definitely comes from religion and spiritualism. It definitely has been co-opted by the West and specifically by white liberal people. And specifically, I think we should observe that. I think we should be self-aware that, like, white people love, and I don't know what it is, white leftists, progressives, love to identify as non-binary. Most of the people of color that I know, most Black people, Middle Eastern people, Asian people who have that moment in their lives always end up coming back to sort of a binary existence. And I don't know what that is. Because remember, as much as, like, I can stereotype, I can't account for every individual. So I'm sure there's a Black person out there or an Asian person or a Middle Eastern person out there who's identifying as non-binary and feels very good about it. But again, if your identity is rooted in how other people see you, I don't think it's real. And so if you're like a Judith Butler or somebody along those lines who's a cis woman who acknowledges you're a woman but also non-binary because it's gender non-conforming, I think you're kind of playing a facade. My identities aren't rooted in other people. My bisexuality isn't because of society. My femininity or masculinity, depending on how I choose to present, has nothing to do with society. Not anymore. When I was younger and insecure, yes, but I'm old now. I'm in my 30s and I know who I am, and I most certainly do not need the world to tell me who I am. And so often when we're having these conversations, what I've noticed is people choose identities based off how the world sees them. I don't know why this is up. Oh, our dress is masculine. That's not why I didn't mean to have that up. Okay, so this thing here, Harry Styles, what is he from, One Direction? I hope so, because I don't remember. But he wore a dress on, what was it, Vogue? And it was really controversial, and everyone had something to say about it. And the thing that was funny about it was there was there was a conflicting understanding of this. Now, I don't care if men wear dresses because I think people like Jaden Smith, oh my God, like, I'm not gonna lie, like, right? Like, look at this man. Like, he really is a handsome young dude, and he pulls off sort of like feminine wear very well. But is it doesn't make it masculine because a man is wearing it. And one of the issues I saw with the Harry Styles conversation was that Harry Styles' dress was a masculine statement. And I take major issues with that because, again, it's like men want to co-opt what has been created and fashioned by women for women and embraced as a feminine piece of clothing. And once again, when they wear it, oh, it gets to be masculine. Why are you so afraid of being feminine? Like, why are men so afraid of saying, yeah, it's feminine and I'm wearing it? Like, just own it. Versus saying, oh, well, this dress is now masculine because it's being worn by men. It just seems so fucking hypocritical, right? Now, Harry Styles apparently has been gender bending and messing with his fashion. Here, I'll go to this one. Fashion for a while. Like, apparently this isn't new for him. But a part of me, I don't know, I take real issues, I guess. I also take issues that people have to find alternative identities to feel comfortable in their own skin. The fact that Sam Smith came out as a they, like, this is all very interesting to me because a part of me just, I hear their conversations and their reasoning for being these things is always, well, I don't stand, I'm not like other people. And because I'm not like other people, I must be something different. Like the person who wrote me on my Patreon, God bless you if you're listening to me. And when I say God, I mean the goddess of all titties. But like, they wrote me and they said, the other day you called me like I said, you're doing great for a human. That's what I said to them. And they were like, I don't identify as a human. They gave me the word they identify as. Apparently there's a Reddit thing about it, but I'm not on Reddit. And so they were like, can you not refer to me as a human? Cause I am not a human. And I was like, no, I'm putting down my foot. No, because it is so absurd at that point that I can't handle it. The reason I mentioned that book with the priest earlier is because he even mentioned that. He mentioned how human beings were going to get to the point where they couldn't identify the most simple fact about our reality, which is that we're humans. And I think that's so interesting. Like, human beings are individuals, and the individual isn't always predictable. But in general, in terms of numbers, we are pretty predictable. We predict every year how much homeless we will have, or how many people won't have houses, or how the market will go. We can predict, in general, what hordes of humans will do, especially with social media. Documentaries like The Social Dilemma points out very clearly that there's obviously a little puppet master going on. But you need to be in control. You need to know that these ads are for you. So you need to be more aware of what you're clicking on and what you're consuming. Like, I don't click on any story with the Kardashians. That's my rule. Do not click on any article with the Kardashians because, one, it's never going to matter unless I have to cover it for work. And two, and then in that case, I use incognito. But still, I don't want my feed to be full of Kardashian crap. So I make it a point, Brittany, do not click on Kardashian crap. Don't do it. So obviously, Ben Shapiro and Candace Owens got really, like, popular for covering the whole Harry Styles thing. And it's funny because, like, both of those people are, like, I don't know. They both annoy me for different reasons, but for also different reasons than they annoy other people. So it's kind of funny to me because, again, I grew up in conservative talk radio. I was supposed to have a show. I was, like, doing little promos for it, like, trying to get picked up by somebody. And now that I'm more of a, I'm a registered independent, I'm a person who just, like, I see the good in all things and the bad in all things. So for me, I don't do political sides. I vote differently every year for different presidents. I vote a Democrat, Republican. But Candace Owens and Ben Shapiro follow a script, and in their bubbles and their realities, like, this is an attack on men. I do think, though, there is a trend happening. My brother and I were on Grindr, Tinder or something. He's on social media, and he was showing me all the guys that were available. He's gay, and he was showing me all the guys that were available, and he's like, Brittany, everyone's wearing eyelashes and fucking makeup now. And I'm gonna be honest with you, everyone looks like fucking James Charles on Tinder now. And that's not a look that is masculine. And it's also not a look like I'm into or my brother's into. So it's one of those things we have to acknowledge. There isn't an attack on masculinity. There's just a deviation in what is attractive right now, which is pretty normal. When I was younger, skinny white girls with no tits and no ass were popular. And now, you know, big butts and big boobs and curves are popular. So it's not like it's an attack on skinny girls, though there most certainly was sort of a hate of them for a second there. It's more like this is a fashion trend. It's not going to last long. I think we'll be done in 10 years and we'll be back to some sort of, you know, normalcy. But also, think about who uses social media, modern people and young people. Most conservatives and most conservative-leaning people, like people identify very strongly in the binary of masculine and feminine, myself included, we're not on Tinder. Like, is there a Cowboys Tinder? Because I'd be on that. Is there like a, hi, I fit into the binary, but I'm also liberal enough to be chill with everyone doing whatever they want? Like, dating profile Tinder thing? Like, you know what I mean? As far as I know, there isn't. So when we're observing all of these people, what's really interesting to me is how we justify our actions and how we identify ourselves to the world. Even Kristen Stewart, I pulled her up here. Like, she's masculine as fuck, right? She doesn't these suits don't become feminine just because it's being worn by a girl. She dresses masculine because it's one of her favorite aesthetics. And I agree. It's hot as fuck. And all the mass lesbians out there, I see you. You're hot as fuck. You are daddy. And you do not need to identify as anything but a mass lesbian. Okay, so let's go ahead and revert. Oh, actually, it's about that time. Let's take a break and hear from our sponsors right now. Hi, hello. Are you a loser who spends all their time on the computer pondering their own existence? Me too. Join us on Patreon for just $1 to meet hundreds of people who are exactly like you, or nothing like you, or somewhat like you. On Patreon for just $1, you'll have access to live shows, collaborations, and conversations. Oh, and of course, photo shoots of me looking like a hoe. So join us there and enjoy the ride. Thanks. Bye. All right, so there we go. That was our sponsor of today's video because I am not ad friendly or sponsor friendly, so I have to do it myself. Well, you guys have to do it because you're patrons, but thank you for being here. So let's continue the conversations in relations to the levels. So the levels is a little observation tool I made. There's a 1 through 5 category, and most of the world is twos, and twos are just everyday people. People who are born into their bubble and usually don't live outside of a 200-mile radius of it. I live in a small American town, which I moved into. I moved to a state I never thought I would live in. I live in an area I never thought I would live in. I'm from California. I lived in Seattle. I chilled in Dallas. I've traveled all over, and I ended up in a place in the middle of nowhere. I don't share my location because I've had a stalker, and honestly, I don't have time to fuck with that noise, but I love living where I live, and most of the people here are so nice, but they've lived here their whole lives, and so they have a very interesting and different idea of what is happening out in the world. And for mid-America Americans, when they go on Twitter and they see what's happening in the world, for them, they have a very like, wow, I can't believe, like, the world seems crazy. And the world's really not that crazy. I actually joked with a friend. I was like, man, New Year's went off amazingly. Like, no issues, like, no big terrorist attacks. Like, I'm really proud. And he was like, Brittany, there was a protest in Portland. I was like, Portland's not a real place. And the reason I say that is because I lived in the Pacific Northwest for 5 years. And one thing I learned about Seattle and Portland is, like, they're living in such a weird bubble. They honestly are their own planet. And I don't really count what happens there as real. Like, it's real and it's ridiculous, but have you been to Portland? It is not the place I would ever want to be again. Like, I've been there 3 times, and every time all I thought to myself is, like, I feel like this whole city needs a bath. And I don't know about you, but I like clean, fresh, earthy feels. And Portland took feeling earthy as being homeless. And I'm not really about that. And you can talk about economy, and you can talk about how people aren't, you know, able to work and all of that stuff. But I think there's a bigger issue happening here that people just need to acknowledge. So when we observe the world, we can say, like, okay, most of the world is twos. Most of the people are people who are born, raised a certain way, are going to die that way. Now, some people might say that's bad and you should go on a journey of self-discovery. And I believe that. But to do that, you must first identify who you are in relation to existence. Jordan Peterson often talks about cleaning your room before you try to change the world. Get your house in order. And people will say, well, what does that even mean? You know, what does that mean? It means to at least know the basics about who you are before you go around telling people who they are. I mean, if you can't even know that you are a man or a woman by 30, right? If you're like literally like, I don't know if I'm a man or a woman, and you're 30 years old, professional podcast over here, my camera decided to have a moment. But if you are 30 years old, okay, and you do not know whether or not you're a man or a woman, do you really think you have a stable enough kind of concept of reality to be telling other people who they are, whether you think you can call them out for being racist or homophobic or anything else? Because I'll tell you something I found that was really interesting about my YouTube careers. when I first got on YouTube like 10 years ago, I was a conservative, and then I came out as like a liberal, and then I came out as gay, and it was like a whole thing. And I talked a lot about how my parents are like homophobic or whatever. And I realized like a lot of people were relating my family life to theirs, and they were nothing alike. Like, my parents are immigrants. They're from the Middle East. They're from Iraq. Like, the way that they process homosexuality is not the way the media portrays it. They're just simply, because they're old school Catholics. And when you're an old school Catholic, you view homosexuality the same way you view having an affair or doing drugs. It's just a sin. I don't recommend you do it. And my parents didn't handle my coming out in the best way. They didn't handle anything in the best way when I was younger, whether it was moving in with boyfriends or moving out of their house. They wanted something different for me. And even now they want something different for me. But we've managed to have a really harmonious coming together because we've learned that regardless of our political differences, our belief systems, we're humans and we love each other and we're good people. Regardless of my parents' desire to see marriage in a traditional way, they don't hate me. They love me. And I know that they'll struggle if I ever marry a woman, and they'll struggle with, should I see her, should I not? But this is a thing that they're battling with because they live in a reality where God exists. And so when we say that we want diversity, this is what diversity is to me. It means realizing that this person sees their self in relation to God. I'm an atheist. So I see myself in relation to who I am fundamentally as an individual in an existence full of billions of people. Who am I? Who is this person? When I identify and use words to classify who I am and to put myself in a box, I'm doing it for the benefit of the world more than even the benefit of myself. Because the truth is that I'm bisexual. I like men and women. I've tried dating non-binary people. I can't fuck with it. You know what I mean? It's a little too outside my idea of what reality is. So I stick with men and women, and I like traditional values as much as I like being a liberal. You know, I take drugs and I have sex and I've been in orgies and so many threesomes to count, and you've dated multiple people at the same time, and I'm monogamous now, but I've definitely lived a life that a normal, regular, church-going conservative might never even think to exist in. When I watch normie podcasts and they're like, whoa, bro, you had a threesome, bro? Whoa, bro, you had a threesome? Whoa. It's like, for them, it's like the craziest idea. And for me, I'm like, oh, yeah, it's like a Tuesday night. So how we examine ourselves has to also be aware of like how it affects the community. So this is the community section. So a number two is like most of the world. People who live in their bubbles never leave their bubbles. They're cool with their bubbles, right? They're stereotypes. Like, you know how people on Twitter, they'll say like, oh, look at these Trump voters with their shaved heads and beards and plaid jackets, like sunglasses. They're all the fucking same. As if the people who are Biden voters and anti-Trump voters don't all look the fucking same with their pronouns and their bios and their fucking I hate Trump 2020s. Like, they're so funny. Like, humans are so funny. But that's just, humans are gonna human. They're gonna fall into these stereotypes. It's the same way the conservatives say like, oh, I'm anti-big government, but then 9/11 happens and they're pro-surveillance over the phones, you know, the Patriot Act. Or the left will say we're anti, like, the government establishment and the man, but you want to take an injectable vaccine that has only been, you know, in the lab for less than a year. It's like, okay, like, I get it. Humans are going to human. They're going to say they hate cops on one side, but they trust big government to tell them to wear masks. And people will say, like, I hate big government. I hate, like, being forced to do things I don't want to do. But at the same time, they're pro these cops going into neighborhoods and harassing protesters. It's like, I really think people, they live in their own bubbles. They don't have to self-examine. And why would you? Why would you have to self-examine? If you live in a world where you now get to defy what is a man or a woman, you get to defy what is existence. You get to say that I think this is a simulation and actually live a life where people are like, I guess. Like, it's all fine and dandy to have these ideas in your personal life as an individual, but how you interact with your community members in relation to it is the most interesting thing. And again, I'm not giving you answers or solutions. I'm just throwing out ideas for you to then self-examine and say to yourself, okay, how does this help me know who I am? Like, I'm a Middle Eastern woman. I'm Iraqi. I did my DNA test recently. I'm 100% from the Middle East. But often when people are upset with me about how I feel about, like, cultural appropriation or ideas of what is wokeness in relation to race, people will say to me, well, you're a white woman. I'm not a white woman, right? I don't identify with white people. I don't understand the struggle of white people. I try my hardest to understand them. I try my hardest to sympathize and understand that at the end of the day, regardless of skin color, we are humans who want to love and be loved. And in that way, I love you all. I see you all. I understand it. I understand that about humans more than anything. But no, I'm not going to understand what it's like to be, like, a white person. Like, I don't have white culture. I don't know. I was raised in a diverse neighborhood. I was raised with Middle Eastern neighbors and Asian neighbors and white neighbors, and I have like tons of black friends. I'm from Southern California. It's a pretty diverse area. There are pockets, but we're pretty diverse. And when I was in Seattle, I had a lot of friends who were diverse. So it's like, it's just interesting that when we think about what self-examination is, we stop at our identities. But what if you're more than your identity? What does that look like? Well, it looks like humanity. It looks like your humanhood. It looks like your individual right to exist. When you examine who you are past the politics, because politics isn't objective, right? It changes over time. So an example is like, well, right now, I joked with my friend the other day on the phone. I was like, gay people are so cool. Even to conservatives, I hear them all the time. They're like, yeah, I'm pro-civil marriage. Now I'm like, and now it's like trans people's turn to fight for their rights. I'm like, have fun. Like, gay people already went through it. But then now the narrative is, well, gay people didn't struggle as much as trans people. I don't want to play that game with you. I'm going to be real with you. I don't really want to play that game with you, because I most certainly can. And I don't think it's going to end up well for anybody. And I think it's a numbers game, right? Like, I think overall more gay people have probably been persecuted than trans people, but that's because there's not as many trans people. So it's like, okay. And then trans, I only count as trans non-binary. Trans non-binary people, I'm not really counting you as trans, no offense, because one, again, your idea of your identity is co-opted from the East. It's through religion, and I'm an atheist, so like, have fun with that. But also, I don't think it's consistent enough. Trans people, trans binary people have existed throughout time in longevities, versus non-binaryism has only existed through spiritualism. Everyone in America always quotes like India and all of these places of like, oh, they have multiple genders. Yeah, because their religious structure allows them to have multiple genders. You know what I'm saying? It's like, it's made up. Like, I'm an atheist. It's made up. And that's the thing. I don't care if you make up your reality. What I think is that you demand that it's the objective one. So when we're being good community members in relation to our identities, we have to realize that maybe the thing we believe in isn't objective. One of the ways I created peace with my family, my religious Catholic family, was by making sure they understood I do not believe in a God. I literally do not believe in one. Gun to my head. Columbine, gun to my head. Do you believe in a God? Nah, motherfucker, I do not believe in a God. I do not believe in a God. Which means every concept of reality I have is rooted in what I can perceive through that lens. It means that I can't even fathom a reality where like being on OF is like unethical because God. So I was thinking about this the other day. I was talking to a friend about this. Because for New Year's, okay, so for New Year's, my BDSM family and I have this like group in Seattle. It's like my BDSM family. I'm in BDSM. I've been in BDSM for like fucking 10 years plus. I love it. It's a great little subculture. And yes, there's a lot of issues within the subculture that I think comes from us trying to normalize it, which is why I'm anti-normalizing BDSM. But okay, and this is not going to make sense to most people, so just like bear with me through this conversation. But for New Year's, we all got on Discord. We all had our cameras up. And we had my camera, their camera, and porn. Because there's like this BDSM dungeon that does this thing. And it's like porn, but it's not porn. It's like just people doing BDSM things. But again, it's like viewed as porn because it's like double fisting and all that stuff. And for me, it's so normal. It's like, yes, a double fisting New Year's show. And it's like so normal. But for regular people, like in my family, pinup art is considered porn. Stay with me here. And then what I do on OF, like, God forbid, you know what I mean? It's like, for me, porn has been so normalized in my life. And it's because it's like consensual adults. They're doing a thing. They're creating a thing. Nudity in movies. Like, all of the, I never think of these things as outside the norm. And when I'm on, like, when I watch podcasts, like if I'm watching Impulsive or Joe Rogan or anything else, and they're all talking about porn, to the area I was raised in, the group of people I was raised with, like my neighborhood and where I, you don't talk about these things. Like you don't talk about deep throating or, you know, whatever you're going to do. You just don't mention those words. It's considered very uncouth. But that's the world I live in online. Like when I watch H3H3 and I'm just laughing so hard because it's just so funny. And they're talking about things that, for me, it's almost like two worlds I live in. I live in my YouTube world where it's like all my liberal friends and all of us are just talking about bullshit. And then I go home to my parents and I'm like a conservative person who's like, when people are intimate, instead of saying when people fuck like bunnies, it's like, we got to examine, right? We're always doing this. I don't think we should have a one way is the right way. I think diversity is better. I think chaos is better. I think the world is exactly how we want it to be because we exist in this world. So for me, again, when I'm thinking about what it means to be a community member, I think it means getting down to the acknowledgement that we're not all living in the same bubble. And I think everyone has to do this. That's literally how I made peace with my religious family. I made peace with my religious family by constantly reminding them, I do not live in your world. You cannot hold me to your standard. It wouldn't be fair. And it's not fair. It's not fair to say that in my bubble, this is how I see the world. This is how it must be. And therefore, everyone must be like this. Because that's not how everyone's living your life. Now, it's not relativism. Now, this is very important because if you study philosophers and you read about humanity, there is a structure that should exist for your goal. So as an example, you know how they say marriage is for having babies? Technically, it's kind of true. Like, I know if you want to observe marriage as like this commitment between two people, blah, 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 blah. But I'll tell you, one of the consistencies I've seen in people who do adult work or people who are in BDSM or people who live alternatively is most of them don't have children. And if they have children, they stop going to the dungeon and they stop clubbing. So here's the thing. When we live lives as youth, as we're wild and carefree and we think having a child puts a stint in that because it's such a responsibility. If you want to raise a human being who's going to grow up to be an actual productive member of society, yeah, you can't be partying every day. Sorry. And that's the thing. You can say you can, but I'm going to play a game of which kids came out more stable. And I think the partiers are going to lose. And so that's a big deal, is when we decide what kind of a society we want, we have to decide the responsibility of being parents. One of the struggles of parenthood is that people aren't always active in it. One of the underlining factors and issues communities face is not having a two-parent household. We've seen the studies, and I don't know about you, but I'm not mad about it. Humans are gonna human, right? So if we see the studies and then we still go against them, it's just what it is. Like, it is what it is. I'm not mad at the world for doing exactly the thing human beings are gonna do, which is do what they think they need to do in that moment. What I need to do is make peace with the fact that I stick to my values and live it, that I know who I am as a person, and that I can communicate that. My journey has always been very interesting online because I've always been transparent about my changes. I've changed so much on the internet. I've grown so much as a person. And because of that, people don't know what bubble to put me in, and so they feel uncomfortable around me. And I'm okay with that. But the problem is most people aren't. One of the videos I recently made on my channel was about The Cut. They did this thing where this woman was just judging people on their looks based off industry. And one of the things that was most unique was so many people want to be other. They want to be queer and identify as weird, and they want to be unique and they want to stand out. And then they want to be considered normal. You can't stand out and be weird and normal at the same time. Normal is an expectation of society. It's what is common. You know what I mean? It's like, why you want to be, you know, wearing horns and tattoos and then think that basic people who live in Orange County aren't going to view you as other. It's just very strange to me. And I'm a person who has been other her whole life. And I blend really good in communities, but I've been other my whole life. And I've learned that I'm okay with being other. I really love it. But I don't ever expect people to not see me as that. You know what I mean? Like, I am who I am. But there comes consequences with that, right? You might not be able to get the jobs you want or the life you want. I'm not ad friendly. I don't have a larger audience on YouTube. And a big part of that is because of consistency. Like, all my YouTube friends who make YouTube videos always say, don't talk about politics, who you are, or very complicated issues about yourself. Because if you do, you lose audience members. One of the reasons, Andrew Schultz has talked about this too on his little podcast. Highly recommend. Very funny. But he talked about how his Netflix special, he had a guy who came in, wanted to sponsor him, was so excited, wanted his name on the project. And then Andrew went after all his friends. Like, Andrew went after everybody in that special. And he's like, hey, I got to pull my name from this because I could lose business over being associated with you. I don't know why we keep pretending that we live in a world where that's not a thing. And it comes from the left and the right. You cannot pretend that conservatives do not lose jobs because they're Trump voters. Because I've seen leftists get people fired. And you can't say that conservatives weren't getting gay people fired or trans people fired. You know what I mean? So we're all doing it to each other, but in denial that we're doing it. Which is why people get upset with me, because I don't care about getting people fired. I don't think that does anything. And I don't think it matters. I don't care. Like, are you good at your job? I don't care how you think about the world. And I know some people believe that this spills into your work and everything else. But I only think it does with certain people. Because I'll tell you, like, my parents are really conservative, and maybe because they're immigrants, it's not the same. But even though they have a stance that says, like, I'm anti-leftists or liberals or Democrats, they still hire Democrats. Like, they still hire people that are different from them and love them and let them marry into the family. So maybe your circles let it spill into work, but mine don't. I was raised with, if they can do the job, it doesn't matter what they believe. I was raised that. I was shown an example of that. And I think that's important. I mean, no offense, but I've met a lot of people who would be happy to fire a Trump voter or someone who's anti-trans because it creates a hostile work environment. And I've seen conservatives who are happy to fire people for being those things as well. I don't know. I just think we live in a world where humans are going to human. And when we choose about how to identify or how to explain ourselves to the world, we have to understand, like, things mean things. Words mean things. They just mean things, and changing the identifying, like, tenets of those words aren't going to make you feel any better about yourself. They're just going to make you more confused. Human beings need structure, community, and consistency to be happy. Science has done the studies. Religion and spirituality, specifically religion, actually ups your chances of happiness and longevity as a human. And that comes from those three tenets. And so as an atheist, one of the struggles I always had was, how do I find those things outside of religion? And I found them through philosophy. So I highly recommend reading. I highly recommend watching documentaries. I highly recommend, you know, picking a subject you love and reading everything on it. And read everything on it from everyone's perspective. If you just keep consuming your own bubble, you're just never going to learn. You know, read Judith Butler, but also read J.K. Rowling. Those are two different people, actually. One's fictional, one's a philosopher. Hold on. Read Judith Butler because she's a philosopher. But also read, like, all the white guys everyone seems to hate, like Socrates and Plato and Aristotle, because they're amazing. And also read, like, J.K. Rowling as a fictional author because she writes good fiction, and maybe consider her opinions and read people who counter her. You know, because I mentioned her, I feel like I have to preface that. I'm a huge J.K. Rowling fan, sorry. Actually, I have a whole video about J.K. Rowling coming up, but I guess I can actually, no, I'll mention it here because it actually has to do with this. You know how everyone always thinks J.K. Rowling just, like, hates trans people? J.K. Rowling comes from a very complicated past. Her father was so upset she was a girl, he cut her hair, made her wear boys' clothes, and only identified her as a boy for the first few years of her life. Her trauma with gender and sex and understanding what is a boy and a girl is very intense. And so when J.K. Rowling comes out concerned that people are going to have issues with how they identify these words, it can sound turfy. And for me, turf, I've been called a turf. TERFs are trans exclusionary radical feminists. I'm not a feminist. I can't be a TERF. My parents, who are anti-trans because they're Catholic, aren't TERFs. That's not what TERF means, right? So you have to be very careful with your language. And one of the examples I'll give you, and I'll end it with this. Transness is just easy to poke at because it's so obviously, like, huh. But it's not to say that trans people deserve to be poked at. That's not what I'm saying. But they're an easy way to identify the whole idea of, like, even knowing the basics of men and women. I was in Seattle, and at the time I was there, I was really struggling around men because I was still getting over the PTSD I had in relation to a rape that had occurred in my early 20s. And I used to go to this women's event, like, once a week, every 2 weeks, you know, it was like on a Thursday, Tuesday night, I don't remember, but it was really fun. And I would go every time it was there, and it was so fun, a bunch of women, all women, trans, cis, whatever, like, no issues, we've never had an issue. Then one night, a person walks in that I can clearly identify as a man. They literally have a beard. They have, like, just a regular tank top shirt on, you know, like one of those sports ones, and then, like, just shorts. And I was like, oh, why is there a dude in a women's space? And, like, I went up to them and I was like, hi, who are you? And I know in Seattle, you don't want to assume people's gender. So I did the whole, who are you? Introduced themselves as a woman, said that they were newly out, that they were trans, and that they had made the decision to live comfortably in their body that they were made, that, you know, basically not God, but the universe had made them this way and they're not going to change to fit society's standards. And I struggled with that. I talked to them for just like 15, 20 minutes. We had a good conversation. They seemed like a nice person, but they obviously seemed very confused to me. And it triggered me because I, again, was in that space for women, to be around women and people who identified as women, looked like women, lived as women. So I could be away from masculine energy and away from men. And this person was in every way man, had done nothing, even had a beard. And I just sat there, I'm like, okay. And I know some girls have beards, but can we not agree that is an anomaly? And therefore, even strange to see when you do see it. You're like, oh, that's a girl. Ask any girl with a beard. She sure as fuck had an issue growing up with a beard, right? Because it's not a part of our narrative as women. So again, when we decide who we are and how we identify and how we want to identify, we have to understand how it impacts the individual and our community and then how to move forward from that. At the end of the day, I honestly think the answer is live and let live to a large extent. But at the same time, I do struggle with wanting to explore those ideas of ultimate truth, which is why I left politics. Because politics is about winning. It is not about truth. We saw this with this recent election with Trump versus Biden. We saw that people were very determined to win. People, oh, I don't even want to vote for Biden, but man, I have to. No. What? Protest the DNC. Blow up their buildings. Why are you blowing up police precincts when you should be telling the... Don't blow up the DNC. Wait, disclaimer, do not blow up the DNC buildings. But you know what I mean? Like, why are you attacking, like, people who are just trying to, like, have a job and pay for their family's food, right? Cops. When I know there's issues with the police force, but why aren't you going after the police force leaders? Why aren't you going after the DNC who gave you Biden and Harris? Why aren't you going after the establishment? It's like the same way the social dilemma, like, made it clear. The people up top create the chaos down below so we can become more polarized and we can start consuming and always being on the internet to argue about these things that don't matter. So again, you can say you have control of your life. You can say that you're solid in who you are. You can say all of these things. But when push comes to shove, are you sure of who you are? And what are you going to do to find out? We all have different paths, and I'm not judging your journey. But I am going to judge you if you come at me and demand that I question my sense of reality when I am goddamn sure of the basics. I'm a human. I'm a woman. And that's all I need to know to explore the rest of who I am. If you can't even know that about yourself to the day you die, like, I would question that a little bit. Guys, this is the first podcast. I think it went really well. I'm really nervous about how it came out. And now I'm going to have to go edit it. And hopefully it's not a hot mess. Thank you so much for being here and for being a part of it. If you really did like it, please check out my Patreon. I would appreciate it so much. It's just, you know, donate $1. You get live shows. We're doing 2 this month. I've already announced the dates. And you have more conversations, photo shoots, fun stuff for me. Remember, I'm a interesting individual, but I'm also like everyone else. And that's how I think everyone is. I think we're all interesting and everyone's like everyone else. We want to love and be loved. And within that structure, we have our most wonderful nuances. And those should be explored and loved. Okay. Thanks for watching. Have a great day. And I'm going to get off this first podcast. Bye. Stuck in my head. In real life, I'm in bed. My belly's being fed. And I'm okay. I'm just fine. Yet all I do is whine. Not to you in my mind. Cause I know I don't make sense. I've been nothing but blessed. So why's my life a mess? Please tell me. Cause I'm sick of thinking. Yeah, I'm sick of reaching out for the truth. And living life as a fool. Done.